The Susan Brender Show is a radio show online broadcasted on YouTube across the United States and globally. The show features guests who speak about health, spirituality, entertainment, and a host of subjects to enlighten people across the nation. Listen to the show that empowers women and men alike and highlights those who have made a difference. I'm Susan Brender, and this is the Susan Brender Show. Today, I am going to interview a woman who has been involved with education for a long time and a person who has really started her own business. In a sense, she's all like an entrepreneur, and I really want to thank her for being on the Susan Brender Show because she has a lot to teach you. With that said, let me give you a little bit of her profile. Her profile basically is that she opened the doors of Turtle River Montessori School in the fall of 1995 as one of the first five families who were in search of a Montessori school that followed the philosophy in its entirety. She had a clear vision of what she wanted for her two daughters, who were 3 and 8 years old. Now, she has a lot of education, both here in Florida and in New York, and she has a deep conviction that children deserve an environment that will fully develop their intellectual, physical, social, emotional, and inner potentials. And I want to welcome to my show, Bubli Dandiya. I want to understand a little bit about Montessori schools, because a lot of people don't really understand what that is. You know, they're aware of charter schools, they're aware of parochial schools, but they don't know about Montessori. So what is it?
Thank you. Montessori school, that is actually named after physician Dr. Maria Montessori, and she was a psychiatrist as well as a pediatrician and was very interested in learning about brain development and very interested in seeing what would be the most efficient and holistic way of educating young children. She was in Italy, in Rome, and did a lot of research on brain development and finally came up with this concept in 1907. She opened her first school, and the word Montessori is basically, it's not a franchise, it is just the last name of the wonderful Italian woman who started it in 1907.
Yeah. You know, Bubli, it's very interesting that there is a difference between Montessori and traditional schools. If you had to tell people about the school that would really benefit their children, rather, which one would you choose? And, of course, you're biased, but nevertheless, I want to know.
Yes, you know, just to give you a little background, as I was raised in India, I went to a Catholic school, and that was, you know, my very first brush with education. And, of course, at the time, I didn't know whether it was good or bad. But in retrospect, as I grew older, I found that it did not empower me to build myself. That it expected me to follow the adults, the teachers, and look for information from them, and which is what traditional education is. You have a teacher at the center of the room. The children are all sitting at their desks, and they're getting all their information from that one person. They are supposed to listen carefully, absorb, and then try to learn it and then memorize it and eventually regurgitate it for a test. Now, what research has shown is this kind of learning is not very effective, because if you actually quiz a child a few weeks after the test has been given, they do not remember what they wrote, because it was not true understanding of the concepts or whatever they were asked. Now, Montessori basically believes that at a young age, the children's neural pathways have not developed yet to learn abstractly. They need to learn every concept with hands-on, manipulative, sensorial materials that they can touch and feel in order to internalize a concept. So Dr. Montessori designed hundreds of materials that are needed to furnish a Montessori classroom. And any concept that there is to be learned, I mean, when I did my training, I was blown away that, you know, we were teaching cubing and squaring and algebraic equations with actual three-dimensional lessons.
Wow.
And once you teach children with those, they are never going to forget it because it's hands-on and it's interactive. And they're allowed to keep working on it until they feel an inner mastery. And they don't move to the next concept unless they have had that mastery. So, you know, A, you do not have to rush them because they don't have to rush to stay in step with the rest of their peer group. And you also don't have to wait for the others to catch up. If one child is advanced and has already understood the concept, that child can move on. So
yeah.
The difference in traditional and Montessori mainly is that in Montessori, you follow the child. In traditional, the child follows the teacher. So
right.
It's a completely opposite concept.
Yeah.
In Montessori...
No, absolutely continue. I have a question for you, but needless to say, I want to hear the rest of what you have to say.
Yeah. What I have to say is that, you know, in Montessori, we don't have designated desks for children. It looks like a very open setting with the classroom divided in a few areas with, you know, English language arts. You have, you know, of course, the math and the science and the geography and the social studies and the biology. I mean, all of these different areas have actual three-dimensional materials sitting there in a sequence in the sense that once you master a concept in that sequence, you go to the next concept. So it's not passive learning, it's active
mm-hmm.
learning. And every child is actually, the younger they are, the more they have to be taught individually. So as
right.
an individual child is given a presentation and learns it, moves on to the next one and to the next one. So in a sense, it is a very individualized, differentiated curriculum because you are really working with the child at his or her pace.
Yeah.
And that takes away a lot of stress in the child's mind.
Perfect. You're leading straight up to my next question. You know, today we're dealing with, when you talk about stress, there's a lot of stress going on
mm-hmm.
because of the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, children have to do virtual classrooms.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, how do you operate that? And is it a good way to learn? Because the way you described it, it sounds like it isn't. But I want to understand
yes.
in this,
yes.
I mean, we have no choice, do we? So in
yes,
this day,
don't.
What do you do
yes.
about that?
Okay, so the way we are working through this challenging time is that, you know, personally, our school goes up to 8th grade. There are schools that go up to 12th grade, there are schools that stop at 5th grade. You know, what we have found is that the older children, meaning when I say older, I mean first through 8th grade children,
mm-hmm.
they are more prone to thriving with the virtual program much more than you would expect.
Right.
Our virtual program is very much like being in the classroom, and there is a lot of interactive work. There is a lot of dialogue between the teacher. They have individual times with each child when they go back and touch base with them and see, you know, what they have understood, where they need help. And because as the children get older, in I think I by about fifth grade, the materials lessen and the abstract learning takes over. You understand?
Yeah.
Because now
Yeah,
the
sure.
children have to be prepared. Starting in second and third grade, we start preparing them to work on the foundation that they have had with three-dimensional materials and transition them into abstract thinking. So as far as that age group is concerned, we have half of our school is actually in person because parents badly wanted that, and we had to work really hard to create a safe environment and follow all the protocols. But the other half have decided to do virtual. And we have been, you know, I think very happy to see that we have succeeded at it. We have had our parents tell us that they are loving it, the children are loving it, and in some cases, the children are much more focused because there's no distraction around them.
Yeah, they're an exception, Bubli, because in public schools, it's people tell me, and of course I don't know whether it's 100% true, but they tell me that a lot of the kids don't even go on the computer. They don't even participate in school.
Right.
And
right.
your schools are very different.
Yes.
Now, the one thing I want to understand is the training of a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Is the training of a teacher very different from the way they did it for public schools? Explain that to me, if you will.
Extreme. Yes, absolutely. It's extreme. It's actually diametrically opposite of what a traditional school teacher is trained as. A traditional school teacher is trained to control the children. They are trained to, of course, the subject material has to be the same. I mean, we learn all of the, you know, disciplines the way public school teachers or traditional school teachers learn.
Mm-hmm.
However, our modalities are different. We are learning it in a different way with hands-on materials. The platform is different. The concepts are the same. The biggest thing in Montessori is to create an environment that is unconditionally respectful to the child, and that is peaceful, harmonious, and has no stress and no competition in the air. The energy is completely comfortable. The children feel like they are at home, except that they have more children around them. So once we create that, and that is only possible if the teachers who are running that classroom are trained in the methodology. And this is part of our training. How do you create an environment where the children are completely comfortable, they are not intimidated by anything, they feel safe, they feel nurtured, they feel respected, and once you do that and take all the stress out of the environment, the children actually want to learn. You have to get out of their way because they are so eager to learn. And so this training only comes with all the work that is put into it during, you know, when we do our Montessori certifications. The main thing a teacher needs to remember is you are not going to control your environment. You are going to empower the children to control their own environment because you are going to explain to them why we need to behave a certain way, why we need to conduct ourselves a certain way in order for this school classroom community to thrive. And so if you break those rules, your community is going to break down. And once the children understand that, they are, you will be amazed to see how beautifully the environment runs without a teacher yelling from across the room or telling them to be quiet or saying, you know, don't do this or don't do that. it's like these little people going about their work, going from one lesson to another, and, you know, practicing it or being presented a lesson. It's like a scene that you would not believe until you see it. It's,
wow.
It's magical, because we underestimate our children, and we believe that unless we control them and direct them constantly, they are not going to learn. But it is actually we are taking away their joy of learning by having them follow our agenda.
Yeah. You know, Bubli, in public schools, they're taking away all of the arts. I mean, there used to be a lot of programs for music and for dance and for painting and various other creative things. But today, they've taken that away. Does Montessori schools involve or get children involved in all kinds of creative things? And if so, you know, how do you kind of make it so that it is so entertaining that children from a very early age really learn to play music, to sing, to dance, to do art? How do you do that? And is it involved in your curriculum?
It is part of their day, you know. It's part of their week. So they get all of this that you have mentioned, they get as a part of the week. And, you know, creativity is something that needs to blossom. And, you know, children come all wired for creativity and innovation. Now, the problem is that we squash it because we pay so much more attention to teaching them, you know, the reading and the writing and the math, and we forget that there are so many other ways to teach them that will bring joy and give them a completely different perspective of learning, of the world, of the classroom, of the beauty of all of these different things you mentioned. So our children, you know, our children love coming to school. You will be amazed. Our children are, our parents tell us at school that, you know, when you have a long break, the children are, you know, saying, when are we going back to school? Because they miss it. It's such a beautiful environment for them where they can see that they are being respected. There is never a punishment. There is never a negative attention brought to them. You know, the goal in Montessori is not just to follow the disciplines. The goal is to give the children life skills, to make them understand their role in their family, in the community, in the country, in their state, in the universe. You know, it's really important for them to know who they are, what their roles are, and where they are going, you know, what they want to do with their lives. So it's a much bigger, deeper, and a much more meaningful philosophy where the children that come out of Montessori are, they think differently. They think differently. Their sense of self is different. They are aware of their challenges. They know it's okay to have them and not feel any less than the next person. They need to know that they have so many gifts and that they need to celebrate those gifts as well. So once a child becomes really comfortable in their skins, there is no one who can stop their success.
No. So you're talking all about self-esteem and self-confidence, and you're making the argument that Montessori schools give the kids an opportunity to feel really good about themselves.
About themselves.
That's right. And I'm, you know, I know after, believe it or not, I was a teacher many, many years ago, and I recognized the fact that, number one, teachers need to know much more than kids if they want to be good. I mean, that is one of the issues, because some of the teachers really, especially in this digital age, they can't even do what the kids can do. So that's very interesting.
Right.
The second part of this is, what about civics? You know, we're dealing with a very divisive and a very difficult time, a challenge for our politicians. And we need kids to understand so that they can participate at a certain age in all these politics and all these voting situations. Do you get your children, your older ones, to understand a little bit about civics? Because it seems that it's just been eliminated.
Absolutely. And, you know, being the kind of a pedagogy that we have in the Montessori, you may have heard of course, everyone's heard of the Model UN. Yes?
Sure.
When you go, there is such a thing as Montessori Model UN. And the children basically pick a country they're going to represent. They study it in depth to see the issues that that country is facing. And we took our children, our middle school children, to the actual UN in New York. And they were Montessori students from all over the world who were all representing different countries. And they went through the entire process of how the UN is run. And they went to the actual building. They sat exactly like the other representatives of countries sit, with their name cards and their countries they're representing. And they run the meeting as though it was real UN. Now, just imagine how beautiful that experience is for them.
You know?
And they got a chance to talk with, to get a round table with the ambassador to Afghanistan, from Afghanistan. And it was an incredible experience. But for that, you have to study civics. You have to study, you know, how the government works. You have to study how, you know, how you basically perceive politics. You know, what is happening in our world? What is happening in our country? And all of that is starting at 3 years old. These children are being exposed to that. We have what we call, say, a peace festival. And we have each classroom studying a culture and a country or a culture and researching it, and then we have like a big festival in our playground with booths and gazebos, and everybody's decorated them for their country, and then they're sharing their knowledge with the other students, you know?
That's right.
So it's, and also just learning how to conduct yourself in your little community teaches them how they're going to translate this into the bigger world.
Exactly.
You know, the civic sense is very strong in a Montessori classroom.
Yeah.
So,
No, I was just going to say that many months into the global pandemic, we've learned valuable lessons, and I want to know the number one valuable lesson that you think your kids have learned or your teachers have learned?
I think that the number one lesson the teachers have learned, and as a matter of fact, all of us have learned, is that the human spirit is very resilient and that the children are very capable of stepping up to the plate and making things work, even though we are challenged and not socializing. And the fact that we are so closely, deeply connected emotionally and socially with the children in our classrooms is extremely helpful in our virtual settings. Because these children, we know these children like the back of our hands. We work with them one-on-one. We work with them. We have advisories where you know, one teacher will have 4-5 children in her advisory, and they meet regularly to talk about any other issues that have been bothering them, you know?
Yeah.
So my point is that that relationship and rapport and connection has made the teachers see that not only are they able to make it successful, it is also the children's spirit that is extremely resilient. So the big lesson is that the human spirit is so resilient, and you never find out unless you are in a situation like this.
Right. You know, it's an interesting thing, Bubli, but what you've told their audience is such a inspirational kind of thing for them to think about and also for them to follow. And it's a perfect time for us to say goodbye, but I just want people to know that you're the person, and am I correct by saying that you started the Turtle River Montessori School? And if so, if people want to learn a little bit more about your school, about Montessori, how do they do that?
You know, if they just simply go to turtlerivermontessori.com, they will get to our website, which talks a lot about the philosophy on a much deeper level. And if you go on Google and just put Montessori philosophy, you will get hundreds of articles. And, you know, just as a little tidbit, I want to tell you that the two men who started Google attribute their success to being Montessori students. They had gone to Montessori, and they said that is what made us who we are. Jeff Bezos from Amazon went to Montessori. You know, so what I'm saying is that it is actually a very well-kept secret, but there are Montessoris all over the world and are doing wonderful work. And you can also find many, many videos on YouTube if you simply just put in the Montessori method.
Sounds great. Well, my guest today has been Bubli Dandiya, who runs a wonderful school, a Montessori school called the Turtle River Montessori School. And if you want to get in touch with her, she told you how to do it. And I want to thank her for being on the Susan Brender Show. It's just been great. Thank you.
It's been my pleasure. I am so grateful that you allowed me to share this beautiful philosophy.
Thank you.